Listen to this audio clip before and after I turn on an EQ boost centered at 4 kilohertz. Did you hear the E sound when I engaged the EQ boost at 4K? Well, what if I told you there are cues like this throughout the frequency spectrum that you can use to more easily identify frequency imbalances by ear? In this video, I'm going to teach you those cues so that you can train your ears for better sounding mixes. The ear training framework I'm about to share with you had a huge impact on my mixing and listening skills, but I have to warn you, you may never hear music the same way again, but you will be able to listen much more objectively and critically after learning this method. So if that sounds good to you, be sure to watch until the end of the video and download your free copy of the ear training guide at audiouniversityonline.com/eartrainingguide. You can find a link to the guide in the description box below this video. Finding the right frequencies was mostly a guessing game during my first few years of recording and mixing music. Eventually, I learned the trick where you sweep for frequencies with a parametric EQ until you hear the problematic frequency, and then you take it out with the EQ. That technique was useful, and I still use variations of it every once in a while today. But you've got to be very careful when using that method. Applying a 12 dB boost to anything can potentially make it sound terrible, so it can be a very slippery slope that might lead you to hunting for problems that aren't really there. As I showed you at the beginning of the video, 4 kHz corresponds to the sound E, and we can assign a vowel sound to each of the octave frequencies between 250 Hz and 4 kHz. 250 Hz, ooh. 500 Hz, O. 1 kHz, ah. 2 kHz, A. 4 kHz, E. I've got a demonstration that might help you understand what's going on here. This is a talk box. The tube is directing the sound from the speaker in the box into my mouth, and the microphone is picking up the sound that exits my mouth. You don't need a talk box to practice ear training, but it'll be helpful for demonstrating these frequency cues in this video. All I need to do is make the shape ah with the talk box, and this analyzer will show a buildup at 1 kHz. And the same goes for the other frequencies between 250 Hz and 4 kHz. You'll notice that I didn't perfectly create a 1 kHz resonance at first. It took some fine tuning. And that's to be expected as I continue to improve my muscle memory. Whether you practice with a talk box or just practice making the shape of each vowel sound with your mouth, your accuracy for identifying each vowel will build over time as well. For the frequencies above 4 kHz, you can listen for sibilance. Sibilance is the hissing quality often used to describe the S sound. To identify 8 kHz and 16 kHz, we're going to listen for the distinct character of the sibilance. 8 kHz is a pure S sound, while 16 kHz is a bit sharper, like an S mixed with a T. The frequencies below 250 Hz don't really correlate to vowel sounds or sibilant sounds, but instead to haptic sensations. Haptics are the felt vibrations of sound throughout the body. You might have experienced haptic sound at a concert with powerful subwoofers or at a fireworks display.
Plus center.
If you listen carefully to the following clips with full range speakers, you can feel the low frequency energy in your body. The way I was taught to feel it is to feel 125 Hz in your chest and 63 hertz in your abdomen. The low frequencies do take a bit more practice, and they are much more difficult to hear on small speakers. So don't worry if these are more difficult to feel at first. For many people, just hearing about this method for the first time makes an immediate impact on their listening skills. Let me know in the comments if that's the case for you. I remember noticing that I could hear each of the frequency band cues in everyday situations after I was only first introduced to this concept of listening for vowel formants and cues. Now that you're aware of the sound or sensation associated with each octave band, you have reference points that will become like second nature to you as you continue to practice. For help starting your practice routine, download the guide I mentioned earlier. The guide will link you to a free web-based tool that allows you to practice with pink noise or to import your own audio wave files. Follow the step-by-step instructions in the ear training guide at audiouniversityonline.com/eartrainingguide to get the tool set up properly. And if you want to see a more practical use of this method, check out the video that's on your screen now. I'll see you there.